Today, Professor Juan will give us a plenary talk called New Potent and Solvable Approximations of Almost Riemannian Structures. Nice to have you.
Yes. So many thanks for the invitation. It's always a pleasure to participate to the school and workshop on Lee Theory, even if it is in at distance this year, this special year, this special 2 years even. So it is a joint work with my PhD student, Ronald Manriquez, who will give a talk just after me. And we will explain some different things about the same topic. So the our problem is about what we have done is about solvable approximations, mainly of almost Riemannian structures. Because in some cases, the nilpotent ones, which are very well known, the nilpotent one fail to describe correctly the almost Riemannian structure. That is, the almost Riemannian structure, when approximated by the nilpotent one, turns to constant rank Subriemannian structure. So in my talk, I will first talk about Subriemannian geometry with very elementary things, then almost Riemannian geometry, again with very elementary things. I will recall how nilpotent approximations are built and explain their limit for almost Riemannian geometry, and explain what we have built. Well, I apologize for my accent, which is absolutely French. I know that, but I am too old to change anything now. And for the beginning of my talk, that will be very elementary. I think I will talk of things that are very well known for most people, but it's like this. So about Subriemannian geometry, I will start with the simplest example, which is the classical example on the Heisenberg group. That is, we consider the two vector fields, the two following vector fields, 1, 0, 0 and 0, 1, x. And they define a Subriemannian structure because their bracket is gives a third direction, so the rank condition is satisfied. And they define the Subriemannian structure through the control system, the classical control system. The geodesics are computed. First, we should consider them as orthonormal, an orthonormal frame, not of R3, but only on the distribution they generate. And we can obtain the geodesics through the Pontryagin maximum principle. Very classic. This is very certainly the simplest example on the nilpotent Lie group Heisenberg. And we can compute some very elementary things on this group, which are the followings. Because here we can follow, if we take U1 equal 1 and U2 0, we can follow only X, or we can also only follow Y. So if U is 1, 0, then the differential equation is the following, very simple. And the solution is also very simple. That is, we follow horizontal lines in the direction of X. If U is 0, 1, we follow only the vector field Y. And things are almost as simple, except for Z, because in this time, we can go in the Z direction if X is not 0. So that if we follow the vector field x, y, minus x, y, minus y, each vector field during the time t, we do what follows. From 0, 0, we go to t, 0, 0, and then to this point, then to this point, and to finish, we arrive at the point 0, 0, t2. That is, actually, we have followed the bracket of x and y. What is interesting here is that we can notice it has some importance for the nilpotent approximations, that we can go in the direction of x or y at speed one, actually the distance is equal to t or proportional to t, but in the z direction, the direction that does not exist at zero, the distance is given by t squared. So you see, the distance is, if we compare to the Euclidean one, it is shorter, much shorter for t small. Generally, this kind of thing happens only locally. Here it is global because the Lie group is nilpotent. Well, we can generalize this example by considering subriemannian structure, more general. Here I will consider only constant rank subriemannian structure. Of course, we can also consider non-constant rank. This includes Riemannian structure, almost Riemannian structure, and so on. But if we consider constant rank subriemannian structures on a manifold of dimension n, it can be locally defined by a set of k vector fields such that the rank is constant equal to k at all points, but the rank of the Lie algebra they generate equal to n. That is one condition, and we get a metric on considering it, this set of vector fields, as an orthonormal frame. And it is well known that we have interesting models on nilpotent Lie groups. Of course, all this can be defined not locally, globally, with the distribution and so on. But since our point of view here is only local, it's much, much simpler to consider only the definition by vector fields. On the other hand, we have also almost Riemannian geometry. This is, I will begin by the also very well known example, the Grouchin plane. This is R2. And in on this space, we consider two vector fields. The first one is constant, 1, 0, but the second one is not. It is a linear vector field, linear in the classical meaning, linear vector field, so that we get, if we consider them as orthonormal, we get a Riemannian metric as long as x is not zero. If x vanishes, then it degenerates because the distribution is one-dimensional. So it's why it is an almost Riemannian structure. It is not regular. The rank is not regular. It's not constant. There is what is generally called a singular locus. It is the locus where the rank is not maximum. And but the rank condition is satisfied. The rank condition is satisfied since the bracket of these two vector fields gives the missing direction, missing when x equals zero. This is well known, and it is a simple example that can be completely analyzed and computed. You can find that in the work of Boscan, for instance. Well, more generally, an almost Riemannian structure can be locally again defined by a set of n vector fields. Here we need n vector fields since it is Riemannian on an open and dense subset, such that the rank is full, is n out of the singular locus. And it is required that the singular locus exists. It is not empty. If it was empty, it would be a Riemannian structure, simply. But with not, with empty interior. Because if the interior was not empty, there is an open set on which the rank is not constant, it would be a kind of constant rank subriemannian structure, very different. And of course, this cannot happen in a with analytic vector field, because in that case, if the interior was empty, was not empty, the rank would be nowhere equal to n. Well, this is yes, and of course, the rank condition is required to be to ensure the fact to have a complete metric. And the metric is defined by considering this vector field as an orthonormal frame that degenerates at some point where the norm and the scalar product, the inner product, are defined only on some distribution. Well, of particular interest are, for in my opinion, are the linear almost Riemannian structures on Lie groups. So they can be defined. Of course, we could define general ones on Lie groups, but these ones are defined in the following way. We pick a set of n minus one left invariant vector fields and one linear vector field. I recall that a vector field on a Lie group is linear if its flow is a one parameter group of automorphisms, or equivalently, if it is zero at the neutral, at the origin, and its bracket with any left invariant vector field is again left invariant. The two definitions are equivalent. And in case where the group is abelian, the linear vector fields are linear in the classical sense. Of course, here I give the definition for only one linear vector field. It can be extended. This definition can be extended in two ways. We can consider n minus s left invariant vector fields and s linear ones. It can be extended also on homogeneous spaces, because the left invariant vector fields can always be projected on the on homogeneous spaces, and under some conditions, linear vector fields too. So there are two extensions. And just one word, what we call with Victor Ayala linear vector fields are in the literature, for instance, in Bourbaki, it is they are called infinitesimal automorphisms. Well, it is the same thing. So the Grushing plane is one example of this. It is an example on the abelian Lie group R2. Well, here it's very easy to build examples on the Heisenberg group. So I consider the two vector fields that I used previously to define a subriemannian structure, and I add this vector field, which is linear. It is clearly zero at the origin, and it is easy to compute that the brackets with the basis vector are all equal to zero. So are all left invariant, minus y for the bracket with x and zero for the other ones. Of course, the wrong condition is satisfied, because it is already satisfied by only these two vectors. And the rank is full out of the singular locus, which is here x, the plane x equals zero. So we get here a model of almost Riemannian structure on the nilpotent group Heisenberg. I emphasize nilpotent because it will be important in what follows. Well, now I have to explain a little bit what are privileged coordinates. I will not really define them. That's not the point. But to obtain privileged coordinates, we have to consider a set of k vector fields around the point. But here, the point will always be zero in Rn. It doesn't matter. So zero is satisfying. And they are assumed to satisfy the wrong condition. It is important, because if not, the privileged coordinates are not well defined. So as you know, we can compute a flag of distributions. The first one is generated by the vector fields. The second one by the vector field plus their brackets, and so on. But we will consider the evaluation of this distribution at zero, at p equals zero. So we have a flag of subspace of the tangent space at zero, but it's here it's Rn. We have a flag, and for one finite indice, we get the full tangent space Rn because of the wrong condition. So we know that it is this sequence is finite. And the integer R is the degree of non-holonomy at P, at the point P equals zero. Well, what are privileged coordinates? They are coordinates x1, xn that I have written, sorry, very roughly speaking, because it's not a good definition. At each coordinate, we give a weight, wi, that range from the 1 to the degree of non-holonomy at P, that is R. And these coordinates are assumed to be in order such that the weights are increasing. More or less, the weight of each coordinate is related to the number of Lie brackets necessary to move in the direction xi. So if we denote by n j the dimension of delta g, the distribution at zero, then we get exactly n1 weight equal to 1, and n2 minus n1 weight equal to 2, and so on up to r. There are theorems in books of Belaïch and Frédéric Jean that prove that privileged coordinates always exist. So in privileged coordinates, we can define the weighted degrees of monomials. For instance, if we take such a monomials, x1 at the power alpha 1 and so on, the weighted degree is alpha 1 w1 plus and so on. This is exactly the degree of a polynomial, the classical degree of a monomial, but with some weights. This is for functions. If we consider vector fields, the weighted degree of this vector field, d over dxj, is minus wj. So that the weighted degree of this kind of vector field, this is the monomial multiplied by d over dxj, is so this weighted degree is alpha 1, the weighted degree of the monomial minus wj. Well, minus wj. Well, so we can consider an example, the following example. Always the same, 1, 0, 0, and 0, 1, x. Here the coordinates x, y, z are privileged with weight 1, 1, 2. This corresponds to the what we found when we compute the not geodesic, but some passes. And in the direction of x and y, the speed is 1. And or it's proportional to t, but in the z direction, it is proportional to t square. So the weighted degree of d over dx is minus 1, and the one of d over dz is minus 2. And if we consider this vector field, w, here, we can decompose it in three components according to the weighted degrees. We obtain homogeneous components. So the first one is of order minus 1 as just one monomials. The components of order 0 as two components, because here we have x plus 1, d over dx minus 1, so we get 0. And here z plus 2, but d over dz minus 2. And we have one component of order 1. Now, if we go back to a general set of vector fields around zero, each xg of this one of these vector fields, not any one, can be decomposed into a series where each xj s is a component of homogeneous order s. Here, what is called the holonomic order of xg will be minus one if it is not zero. It is the weighted order, the weighted degree of the lowest term. In general, this non-holonomic order is greater than or equal to minus r. Why? Because to obtain something very the less value that we can obtain is d over dxn, which is equal to minus r, because r is the greatest value of wj. So here, the holonomic order of a vector field is always greater than or equal to r. But for the defining vector field, this one, the holonomic degree is at least equal to minus one. So it starts at minus one, and then we have, in general, an infinite series of terms. And the nilpotent approximation of xj is the first one. It is xj, it is the component of homogeneous order of minus one, the first one. So why people have considered the nilpotent approximations? For several reasons. The first one, the Lie algebra generated by the approximating vector fields is nilpotent on finite dimensional, always. I will not enter into the details, but the order at P of a bracket, of a Lie bracket, is the sum of the order of the vector field. So when you take a bracket of two vector fields, x1, x2, for instance, you get a vector fields of order minus two or zero, if the bracket is zero. So computing the brackets, you have a limit of in the length of the brackets, the limit being given by R, the degree of non-holonomy. And since the components are polynomial, it's naturally finite dimensional. A second reason is that the rank condition is preserved. It should be satisfied by x1, xk to define correctly everything, but automatically it is also satisfied by the nilpotent, the approximating vectors. And the most important point is that these vector fields with a hat induce a distance, generally written d hat, which is a good estimate of the distance of the original vector fields. This means that, of course, we have a big advantage because the computation are much simpler with the approximating vector fields because they live in a nilpotent Lie group. And they give a good approximation of the true distance. In particular, we can obtain approximations of balls and so on. So I will not spend too much time on this, but you can find many details in the two books of Belaish, which is responsible of a good part of this theory, not everything, because people have used this since a long time, actually, but not everything was completely clear before the work of Belaish. And also in the book of Frédéric Jean, it's not so complete as the one of Belaish, but maybe some clearer on some parts. Well. And the starting point of our work with Ronald Manriquez was the three-dimensional generic almost covariant structures. Everything comes from a paper by Boskin and other people. They prove that a generic ARS, ARS in dimension 3 have the following form. X1 can be written like this, X2 like this, and X3 like this. And alpha cannot, is not zero at zero, but beta and beta here and nu vanish at zero. And it is a well-defined ARS as soon as we have one of these conditions. This condition ensures the wrong condition. Here, the singular locus is the locus where nu vanishes, where nu vanishes. So nu, the locus of zero of nu should be not empty and with empty interior. And there are other conditions that I have not written, which are given by genericity. And again, here, the coordinates x, y, z are privileged with weights 1, 1, 2. So that the nilpotent approximation is always of this form, only for generics. In the generic case. So x1 is equal to x, x2 at this form, and x3 at this form. And what can you say? What can we say of this approximation? If sigma is included, is between zero, strictly between zero and pi over two, then it is a linear almost covariant structure on a nilpotent Lie group, on the nilpotent Lie group Heisenberg. Yes. Okay. Because here this term is not zero and here this term is not zero. In the particular case where sigma is pi over two, so the sorry. Yes, pi over 2, this term is 0, so x dot is just 0, 1, 0, but here we have 1. So it is a linear ARS, but not on Heisenberg, on the abelian group R3. And the case of interest for us is the last one, when sigma is 0. Because when sigma is 0, this means that this vector field is 0 everywhere. That is, this vector field is cancelled. So in this particular case, we get a nilpotent approximation, which is no longer an almost Riemannian structure, but a constant rank Subriemannian one. Yes, I should add that this case can happen only at points. I should add something. Generically, the singular locus is a surface, a regular surface. And generically, the distribution, the distribution which is two-dimensional, because it is a singular locus, is transversal to this submanifold. But at some point, isolated, at some isolated point, the distributions becomes tangential to the surface, to the singular locus. And at this point, this vector vanishes. So this vector, so the nilpotent approximation is no longer an almost Riemannian. So we were interested in this with Ronald, and but I want to consider an example. It is the following. This is, I take some particular value of this alpha, beta, nu, which are as follows. So I should say that when considering a nilpotent approximation, we consider this kind of pseudo norms. This is here, there is an exponent which is one over the weight of the coordinate. But here I assume that x2 and x3 have the following form. So that here, if we look at x3, the component of order minus one, the homogeneous component of order minus one is zero. So the nilpotent approximation is zero because d over dx is minus two, and here we have plus two, plus two, plus two. But we have an approximation at order zero. At order zero, we have this term that we denote with a tilde. So what we do is to keep the nilpotent approximations where the vector field is not zero. And if the vector field vanishes, we replace the nilpotent approximation by the approximation at order zero. So it changed some things. The Lie algebra generated by this vector field is no longer nilpotent, but solvable on finite dimensional. And our point of view is not to consider this Lie algebra and the group, the simply connected Lie group this Lie algebra generates, but to consider G, the Lie algebra, it's an error. It's not the Lie algebra, but G is the ideal generated by X1 and X2 in L, not the Lie algebra. And the ideal is nilpotent. And the third vector, x3 tilde, cannot be inside it and acts on it as a derivation. So if we don't consider Lie algebras and ideals, but Lie groups, x3 tilde is a linear vector field on the nilpotent Lie group G generated by G. For instance, if B and C, the coefficient here, if B and C are not zero, then G is the Heisenberg group H2 of dimension 5. Well, so our purpose is the generalization of this. So we consider n vector fields that define an almost random structure locally in Rn. The point P equals zero is assumed to belong to the singular locus. If not, it is just Riemannian. And we have three kinds of vector fields. We have the first ones from one to k that does not vanish at zero. The following ones from k plus one to m that vanish at zero but are not zero. And the last ones were completely zero. And the last ones, we replace them by their homogeneous component of order zero. Actually, I have a little bit cheated because things may be a little bit more complicated because we can have vector fields that are not zero, but linear combinations of the others. But this, it can be solved very easily, and it is just technical and not very really interesting. So I have simplified the problem. So we have four kinds of vector fields. The non-zero at zero, the non-zero vector field that vanishes at zero, and these ones that are replaced by the vector field tilde, that is the homogeneous component of order zero. And we have two cases now. We have the cases where the nilpotent approximation is enough. That is, all these vector fields, x1 hat to xn hat, are linearly independent. In that case, it is simple. We look at the Lie algebra generated by all vector fields, which is nilpotent, because it is a nilpotent approximation. And G is the ideal generated by the vector field that does not vanish at zero. And the Lie algebra G. And the group G stands for the simply connected Lie group generated by this. And we have the following properties, always true. the space RRN is a homogeneous space of the nilpotently group G. And the thing important that the rank of the element of this Lie algebra at P equals zero is full. This ideal is generated by this K vector field. So if we consider only this K vector field, the rank is not full, it's K. But if we consider the ideal generated by these guys, then it's full. And the vector field x1, xk are projection of invariant ones in the Lie group. And the other ones are projections of linear vector fields. Consequently, this set of vector fields define a linear, almost Riemann structure on the homogeneous space Rn, homogeneous space of a nilpotent Lie group. Then we have the second case, where we have to consider the solvable approximation because some vector field vanish from m plus 1 to n. And we replace them by the xg tilde. So in that case, the nilpotent approximation is no longer an ARS. It is a sub-Riemannian one with constant rank or not, but which has nowhere the rank, full rank. We assume, as previously, that these vectors are independent. This one are independent at zero, and we add there is a mistake here. L stands for the Lie algebra generated by the x hat and the x tilde. I think I have copied the previous page without modification. Generated by all the xj and also the x tilde. It is the full Lie algebra. And g is the ideal generated by the same thing, the vector field that does not vanish at zero. And we have a simply connected vector fields. And we get that here, L is no longer nilpotent. It is not even solvable, actually, in general. But we get that G is a nilpotent Lie group. Rn is an homogeneous space of this nilpotent Lie group. Again, the rank of the element of G at P equals zero is full, and everything works. So this is this first vector field as projection of invariant ones, and all the vector fields that vanish at zero, the hat vector fields, the nilpotent approximations that vanish at zero, and this one are projections of linear vector fields. Consequently, we get again a linear, almost Riemannian structure on the homogeneous space Rn, homogeneous space of a nilpotent Lie group. This is important because here L is not even solvable, but G is nilpotent. So some conclusions. I have not spoken about distances. Rodald will do it, but it is important. Something important is that with our what we call solvable approximation, we get a distance which is always a good approximation of the original distance. And a problem is this distance better than the distance provided by the nilpotent approximation? Yes, but not in all directions. In the directions that are allowed by the we add some directions thanks to the vector fields tilde, and in that direction the distance is better. So I will not give details because Ronald will do it in a while. So we get something also important for the structure, that all approximations of ARS, that is nilpotent or solvable if necessary, are linear ARSs on nilpotent Lie groups. So yes, always approximations are linear almost Riemann structure on Lie groups, and these Lie groups are nilpotent. Sometimes it may happen that the what we call solvable approximation is not enough, because it may happen that the vectors tilde also vanish. It is absolutely not generic, but this may happen. So, of course, is it possible to consider approximation at order higher than zero? This seems very difficult for two reasons. The first one is that the generator Lie algebra need not be finite, dimensional in that case. It may be infinite. So this first problem. The second problem is that the vector fields of order larger than zero need not be complete. Here, I have not written that, but all our vector fields are complete because they are or invariant ones or linear ones on Lie group. So they are complete. Our approximations, we call them solvable approximation. Actually, we discovered that this denomination is not correct. Why? Because actually, if we have several x tilde, they live in the set of derivation of the nilpotent Lie algebra. And the algebra of derivation, even of Heisenberg, is not even solvable because it contains semi-simple Lie algebras. So in general, the full Lie algebra, what we call L, is not even solvable. But first, we have not found another name, so we continue to call that solvable approximation. And it is correct in the generic case. Why? Because generically, the singular locus is a union of submanifolds of codimension S square. Of course, with S square smaller than the dimension n. And each strat, the S, is a set of points where the rank is n minus S. This is the first thing. So previously was studied by Boskin and other people, the dimension 2 and 3. But for dimension 2 and 3, there is only the first generically the singular locus has only one component of codimension 1. But generically, the points where some nilpotent approximation vanishes, so the points where the solvable approximation is needed, are only in Z1, in the biggest part, and are isolated. But when there is only one X tilde, that in one linear vector fields, the Lie algebra L is solvable. So I think that we will, for these generic reasons, I think we will keep this denomination. So at the very beginning, we didn't want to work on genericity, but it turns that the different cases, non-generic, are the number of different cases is almost infinite, and it's really too much complicated to study. So we have restricted ourselves to the generic cases. Well, and here is so we have the you can get the find the references. So this is the paper of Boskin, Charlot, Guy, and Mazon. It was Guy PhD. About the generic case in dimension 3. This is one paper with the paper with Ronald that is published. And here you have the two books. And here, at last, I have put the paper with Victor Ayala about almost trivial geometry and Lie groups. And I thank you for your attention.
Professor João. Comments, questions? Please, Adriano.
Hi, Felipe.
Hi.
I think most of the questions that I had, you answered in your last slides of presentations about another orders of approximations.
Yes.
My curiosity, or what I wanted to ask, is exactly because you choose one appropriated approximation when the nilpotent approximation fails somehow, and then you change the vectors by choosing another terms of this approximation, and then
yes.
You get the solvable one. So
yes.
Can we expect it something like, can we expect it somehow that we have another kinds of approximation, even in the finite case? I mean, can you get a semi-simple approximation somehow, or a mix between a solvable, a generally algebra that is not necessarily simple or semi-simple or solvable? And if so, even in this generic case, a non-generic case, as you said, if so, what does that somehow implies in the geometry of the problem? Is there like one idea of what's happening?
I'm not sure to have completely well understood the question. You mean what do you mean by mix between the solvable and nilpotent approximations?
I mean, when you had this nilpotent approximation, yes, and then when your nilpotent approximation wasn't enough to describe at some points, and then you define this new solvable approximation.
Yes.
You get rid of some vector R zero in some points, and then you change it by another order of approximation, and then you have the
yes.
solvable approximation. My question is, and maybe it's will get clearer when Rodrigo, yes, talks about the distance. But my question is, if you have different approximations, what does that change in the geometry of your almost Riemannian structure? I mean, in the solvable one, you probably work, but if you had a semi-simple approximation, is that possible to obtain? And if so, what will change?
The difference between the when the nilpotent approximation fails, in general, we get a constant rank or sub-Riemannian structure. In particular, you can translate it. It is invariant by translations. And it's absolutely not an almost Riemannian structure, because an almost Riemannian structure, something important, it is Riemannian almost everywhere. And with our solvable approximations, we get, in that case, we get a true almost Riemannian structure, which is not invariant by translation. And this is the main, and I absolutely don't know how to get a semi-simple approximation. We call it solvable because the Lie algebra that we obtain is solvable, but actually what we do is just to take the components, the homogeneous components of order zero. And I explain, it seems, for me it's impossible, but maybe it is, but it seems very difficult to use homogeneous components of order more than zero, of positive order. I don't know if I answer your question.
Yes, as I said, as you said, when you take another terms, like the thing, it's really wild, it's really hard to understand. That's why I said that you almost answered this question. And the second one is, when you, at the end of your talk, you said something about where does this that is a solvable approximation, a generically can be called solvable ones, and then you explain, and then you said that generically you have isolated points where this approximation fails. Yes, in the biggest.
Yes.
My question is there a way to understand what happens around, at least around, because usually you are doing this kind of approximation to understand the balls, yes? To understand balls. And my question is, can we still have a picture or an idea of what will happen with this ball centered in these isolated points?
Yes, you will see balls in Ronald's presentation. Yes, of course we can. It is one of the uses of the approximations in general.
Okay, that's it. Thanks.
Luis, please.
Oh, okay, thank you for the talk, Felipe. My question is how tensors of the Riemannian metric, like curvature or changes of curvature, approximates by this kind of approximation. You start with an almost Riemannian manifold, and so in a dense set, it's a Riemannian, so it has a curvature. How does the
it's an important issue that we have not yet looked at, but it is yes. Yes, it's a point on which we should work when we will have finished what we are doing now, because certainly the out of the singular locus, the geometric ingredients of our approximation will be better than the ones of the nilpotent one when it is not an IRS. And so the curvature and so on are things to look at, but it's not done, absolutely not done for the time.
Okay. This might be interesting because let's say when you usually it's a common technique to have maps that approximate other maps are homotopic, for instance. So maybe after a certain degree of approximation, you get the geometries that are the geometry remains, similar by the geometry of the approximated structure is might be similar of the original structure. I don't know. I'm just pointing out this idea, which is quite common in topology or things like that. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you for your talk and for the reply.
No more questions? So thank you again, Professor Philip.
Thanks again for the invitation.